So first I'll open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word. We thank you for the time we have to study it. Help us to always keep the priority of studying your word and putting your word in our minds. Keep that priority high. I thank you for these men, the time they're willing to be here tonight to study. I pray for your insight for all of us, that we all can sort of take something home that we can apply today, tomorrow, to be better Christians than we are now. Thank you, Heavenly Father, again for the word, for its light to our path. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. Okay, Zechariah chapter 8. I always want to review just a little bit, not a lot. I don't want to belabor this stuff too much, but in kind of Old Testament historical overview, remember when you go from creation over here to Ezra, Nehemiah over there, the Zechariah chapters, Zechariah and Haggai that we've been studying, those two of the lesser, the shorter prophets, are way over here. Again, we're in the 400 years before Christ. Okay, so that's the time frame we're talking about. Again, redemptive history. God wanting to have the children of Israel as a chosen nation, them denying that, and then getting all the way over to coming back to Jerusalem, Hittite. Just wanted to point out again, timeline-wise, just wanted to remind you of the state of Israel at this time. This is something that I made up of all the prophets here on the left, or in a couple of them, the gray areas are events, but otherwise they're the prophets in the order in which they actually prophesied in the Old Testament. Just want to point out one thing again that I pointed out before, but on a different diagram, and that is this column here is the kings who ruled during the prophet's time. And it's really sad to say, but the ones that are in black type are the bad ones. The ones that are in red type are the good ones. You see how few red ones there are. Now this represents, if you look at the years over on the right there, this represents something like 350 or 400 years of history, the history of Israel. Okay, from the divided kingdom, from Solomon, the last sole king, and then the divided kingdom, and that's where all this stuff starts. And that's those evil kings. So with Zechariah, we're way down here at the bottom. The return from captivity is in 536. Zechariah is prophesying in 522 to 509. All right? Again, just time frame-wise. God works in our lives sort of in seasons many times. And many times that is predicated on kind of what season we think it is. We'll see more of that in Zechariah tonight. That is to say, the decisions we make. What we decide we're going to look at and therefore become. And we'll see that in Zechariah. It's very, very plain. The lesser prophets, I won't say the minor prophets, they're not minor, but I would say the shorter prophets. These guys were fabulous, and they were just made of steel. They were just made of steel. It didn't matter what happened. They were going to say what God wanted them to say. That's all there was to it. So we're way down here at the bottom. Again, we looked at Haggai before, but and then I talked about the fact, and we'll see this in a later diagram. In fact, maybe we'll come back to this, so it's a little fun. Let's look at this. The timeline of rebuilding the temple. Cyrus's decree to rebuild the temple is in 536, right? So he sends them back in 536 BC. Remember, BC counts down to zero. So we got 536. And then the foundation of the temple is laid, and we read about that in Ezra chapter 3, verse 10. I guess I should have made the type straight. Sorry about that. Next, the work ceases. And that's where if we look at secular history, we have a time frame for the rulers of Persia. We know when they ruled. And we can see within because the biblical narrative will say, in the such and such year of such and such king. So they stopped building. We see that in Ezra chapter 4, verse 1, because of obstruction from the people who were in the north, the Samaritans, essentially. They stop building, and they don't start building again until the second year of Darius. We'll look back at that. But between when Cyrus made the edict in 536 and the second year of Darius, it's about 15 or 16 years. So they lay the foundation, then they stop, okay? And they don't start until the second year of Darius. And then Zechariah begins prophesying in the second year of Darius. In fact, is it in the seventh?
Zechariah chapter 7. Zechariah chapter 7, verse 1. And it came to pass in the fourth year of King Darius. Okay? So these, by the way, we'll look at this too within the structure of Zechariah. Zechariah 7 and 8 are sort of together. And you remember, chapter divisions are artificial in the English Bible. They're sort of together because it's essentially talking about the loss of Jerusalem and the mourning process for the loss of Jerusalem, the different fasts that we, and we'll look at these tonight, the different fasts that they talk about there were instituted by the children of Israel to commemorate events that happened. They were not divinely inspired fasts. There was only one of those. We'll look at that later. But anyway, that's what chapters 7 and 8 really talk about. They talk about the loss of Jerusalem. They talk about sort of the mourning process, even though that was 70 years ago, right, before all this stuff's happened. And then the temple is finished in the sixth year of Darius. So they're, from the time they restart the temple, temple's finished in the sixth year of Darius. So it takes them 4 years once they restart building. So they lay the foundation, and then they let it sit for 15 or 16 years. And then they restart, and then it takes them 4 years to finish. Okay? And the temple that we're talking about is the same temple that we read about in the Gospels, except that Herod greatly embellished it. Greatly, greatly, greatly embellished it. It was a magnificent structure that was then destroyed in 70 AD by Titus. So it was, he razed the whole thing. Except, I think as the story goes, they left like a wall or two or something like that simply to demonstrate how great the structures were that they destroyed. And if you ever go to Jerusalem and you see some of the old wall, you have to conclude that the only way they can build that is that the aliens helped them. Because these stones are huge. I mean, we're talking like these things weigh, based on density and dimension, something on the order of 200 tons. They did this manually. They did not have machinery of any kind other than what the Romans would do with pulleys and that sort of thing. But if you ever go, or when you go, just amazing that they built this stuff. Just amazing. So back to, again, just a little bit of background. Looks like a cartoon there. So Cyrus the Great is the one that issues the edict in 536. And then the rest of his reign through the next one. And then Darius the First, the third king down, he's the guy we're reading about in this chapter. So he rules from 522 to 486. So in the second year of Darius is when they restart building. That's about 520. So you can see that from 536 to 520 was the hiatus. They get the edict. Cyrus says, go back and build the temple, go back and build the wall. They go back and they start, but then they stop until the second year of Darius in 520. Okay. And then we won't go back and look at it, but that's in Ezra chapter 5, verse 1. That's when Haggai and Zechariah are specifically mentioned as prophesying at that time. Because it's during the hiatus. They're saying, okay, let's get going. Now, with that introduction, I'm going to apologize. I think we covered that. So, structure of Zechariah on the whole. We went over a couple of these things 2 weeks ago when I talked about chapter 6. But 1 through 6 is an introduction, verses 1 through 6. 1 through 7 through 6, 8, the beginning of chapter 6, are the visions. There are 8 visions recorded, all of which apparently, at least based on the biblical narrative, happen in one night. Right? And then the last part of 6 is sort of the ceremonial crowning of Joshua the high priest, but also the messianic prophecies that these things were, there was sort of an immediate fulfillment of those things as well as an ultimate fulfillment, which we have not seen, of course, because the messianic temple is not there yet. But none of that stuff has happened yet. And then 7:1 through 8:23, which is the section, part of which we're reading tonight, is really talking about the mourning for Jerusalem and the loss of Jerusalem, you know, as the city of God, so to speak, as their capital. So, Zechariah, let's just read this chapter now. And again, I usually use the King James. It's going to seem a little archaic. So if one of you would be willing to read perhaps a newer translation, or maybe a couple of you would, there's a total of 23 verses. If anybody would be willing to read, that might be helpful. Whoever would like. Yeah, if you would, just read loudly so that everyone can hear.
How much do you want me to read?
10 verses. 10 verses, if you would.
Then the word of the Lord of hosts came, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, I am exceedingly jealous for Zion, yes, with great wrath I am zealous for her. And then this is the new verses.
That's just fine.
Thus says the Lord, I will return to Zion, and I will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. Then Jerusalem will be called the city of truth, and the mountain of the Lord of hosts will be called the holy mountain. Thus says the Lord of hosts. All men and all women will again sit in the streets of Jerusalem, each man with his staff in his hand because of age. And the streets of the city will be filled with boys and girls playing in the streets. Thus says the Lord of hosts, if it is too difficult in the sight of the remnant of his people in those days, it will also be too difficult in my sight, declares the Lord of hosts. Thus says the Lord of hosts, because, behold, I am going to save my people from the land of the east and from the land of the west, and I will bring them back, and they will live in the midst of Jerusalem, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God in truth and righteousness. I will be their God in truth and righteousness. Thus says the Lord of hosts, let your hands be strong, you who are listening in those days, to those words in the mouth of the mouth of the prophet. Those who spoke in the day of the foundation of the house of the Lord of hosts was laid in the end, to the end that the temple might be built. For before these days there was no wage for an animal, any wage for an animal, and for him who went out for him who went out or came in, there was no peace because of his enemies. And I said, all men, one against another.
Anybody else willing to read?
But now I will not treat the remnant of this people as in the former days, says the Lord of hosts. For the seed shall be prosperous, the vine shall give its fruit, the ground shall give her increase, and the heavens shall give their due. I will cause the remnant of this people to possess all these. And it shall come to pass that just as you were a curse among the nations, O house of Judah and house of Israel, so I will save you. And you shall be a blessing. Do not fear. Let your hands be strong. For thus says the Lord of hosts, just as I determined to punish you when your fathers provoked me to wrath, says the Lord of hosts, and I would not relent, so again in these days I am determined to do good to Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. Do not fear. These are the things you shall do. Speak each man the truth to his neighbor. Give judgment in your gates for truth, justice, and peace. Let none of you think evil in your heart against your neighbor. And do not love a false oath, for all these things that I hate, says the Lord. Then the word of the Lord of hosts came to me, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, the fast of the fourth month, the fast of the fifth, the fast of the seventh, and the fast of the tenth, shall be a joy and gladness and cheerful feast for the house of Judah. Therefore love truth and peace. Thus says the Lord of hosts, peoples shall yet come, inhabitants of many cities. The inhabitants of one city shall go to another, saying, let us continue to go and pray before the Lord and seek the Lord of hosts. I myself will go also. Yes, many peoples and strong nations shall come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem and to pray before the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, in those days, 10 men from every language of the nations shall grasp the sleeve of a Jewish man, saying, let us go with you, for we have heard that God is with you.
Okay. This last verse is, I don't know if you, when you are driving on Sunday morning, you know, when you're driving to work, it's not unusual to encounter a traffic jam. Right? It slows you down, don't get there in time, et cetera, et cetera. Wouldn't it be great if on Sunday mornings there were traffic jams? And we couldn't get to church on time because there were too many people? Now, the last couple of verses, that's what that's going to be like. Everybody is going to be flocking. Anyway, let's go back to verse. Let's look from the beginning of the chapter. Okay. This word jealous, I don't know if you feel the same when you, and what your translation translates this as. It's really be better to say zealous rather than jealous, because the word jealous in modern usage is kind of a negative term. But it also points out, and let's look at, we're going to do a little page flipping here. So look at Exodus chapter 20.
Exodus chapter 20 and Deuteronomy chapter 5 are the two places in the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, where the Ten Commandments are recorded. And I just want to point out one verse here because God talks about this. And it's not in a negative sense that God is jealous. It is simply that he desires relationship with us. So Exodus chapter 20, verses 5 and 6. And thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, unto the third and fourth generations of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Yea, this is one place where I will admit to you here only that the King James Version didn't do a good job of verse 6.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Don't repeat it, because if it was good enough for the Apostle Paul, it's good enough for me. But I wanted to point out the third and fourth generations, you know, the generations word is in that verse 5 in King James. But it's not in the second. The difference here is that it's third and fourth generations evil, it's thousand generations good. So look at the dramatic difference between God's wrath and what happens as a result of it, and God's loving kindness as a result of it and what happens because of it. Now, if you think about the time represented by a thousand generations, let's say that a generation is only 15 years. So let's say that a thousand generations is 1,500, right? No, 15,000. Then that time frame more than takes up all of biblical human history. That is to say, if God was kind in the creation, he continues to be that within the context of this verse. Whereas the evil is relatively short-lived. There is a consequence. But the consequence, and if you think about it, the purpose of punishment in this case, of there being a consequence for evil, the purpose is repentance. The purpose is not, I want to make you hurt. The purpose is repentance. So he does it as a result of the decisions we make, which again we'll see here. I mean, the whole captivity, everything that happened to children of Israel, we've seen time and time and time again. It was because of decisions they made. It was because of things they did, even though they were told again and again and again. So I wanted to point that out. But then look at John chapter 2, because we see this same kind of zeal in the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you think about this incident in John chapter 2, we'll read verses, we'll start verse 13. It says, and the Jews' Passover was at hand. You can read other earlier context if you like. And the Jews' Passover was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting. Now, we're not going to go into a lot of background here, but essentially these people were taking advantage of the need for sacrifice, of the need to have something, and therefore making money on and taking advantage of it. Okay? But we won't go into more, and you may know more from your study of this passage possibly than that, but we'll at least say that much, they were taking advantage. And based on what Christ does, we can see that that was the case. I mean, what he does automatically condemns their motivation, right? Because of what he does and how he acts. So, verse, and when he had made a scourge of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple, and the sheep, and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money, and overthrew the tables. Now, just think about that for a minute. We're talking about Jesus Christ, right? We're talking about the Western world's idea of Jesus Christ being the halo over his head and peace signs. So he makes a scourge of cords. And then it says he drives them out. And then it adds, then he drove out the animals. That means first he drove out the people with a scourge. Get out! Get out! And then he drives out the animals. And then he flips over the tables. Now just think about this. I know for me, sometimes I have to work for my Jesus to be able to do that. If you know, that is to say my conception of Christ. Because this was, and the reason this stood out to me is the quote that says here, it's 17. And his disciples remembered that it was written, the zeal of thine house hath eaten me up.
So the zeal was for God, and the zeal resulted in that action to drive out the money changers who were taking advantage of God's law. They were just taking advantage. But just think about your Jesus, your conception of Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, doing that, doing those actions. Just think about that. I included that mostly just because, what was his tone of voice like? He didn't do this without saying things, without telling them to get out. What was his tone of voice like? How did he move? How did he act? This is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, doing this. So, I thought about that with respect to zeal. But then let's look at Psalm 78. This gets back to the fact that, let's flip to Psalm 78 first. These passages that we're going to look at get back to the idea that God's zeal is for relationship with us. His zeal was that our sole devotion for a God would be to the true God, never to a false God. He was not going to give up what was his due when he says in some other places that we're going to look at. I'm not going to give up my due, my praise, to somebody else. His zeal was for our devotion, right? That we would recognize that everything we have, everything we are, the fact that we can breathe, everything is because of him. All he wants is he's zealous for that recognition. I want to be your father. I want you to be my child. Okay. Anyway, Psalm 78. And we won't look at too much here, but let's look at... let's see. 56. Yet they tempted and provoked the Most High God, kept not his testimonies, turned back and dealt unfaithfully like their fathers. They were turned aside like a deceitful bow. For they provoked him to anger with their high places and moved him to jealousy with their graven images. So, how did he become what we would call jealous or zealous for our devotion? What provoked that? The graven images. And interesting that we read in Exodus 20 that he will visit the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation. That says something about the fact that iniquity is trained. It's training. People become, children become what they consistently look at, whatever that is. They become what they consistently look at. And evil cannot be eradicated, the kind of evil that these passages are talking about, cannot be eradicated in one generation because it's generational. That's why, for example, in the United States, my wife is a social worker. She works in a methadone clinic in Winston-Salem. She works with people who are addicted to opioids. She's right smack dab in the middle of all of the news coverage that the whole opioid thing is getting, right? So, just the other day, she related to me an instance where she was working with people in her program that represented three generations in the same family. Three generations in the same family. We're not talking about mom and dad and kids. We're talking about grandma, mom, kids. Three generations. Right? Because kids become what they look at. So I would just encourage you in that context. And I don't have a chapter and verse except for the Shema when it talks about teach diligently your children these words, and we'll briefly talk about that. So, as Christian men, as Christian husbands, as fathers, please be sure that you are worth imitating, because your kids are going to imitate you. They are going to become you, whether you like it or not. People around you that look to you as a leader, they're going to become you, whether you like it or not. So, you better be worth imitating, right? We're supposed to be imitators of God as dear children, right? Ephesians 5, I think, children by your friends, Lord. Yeah, be imitators of God as your children. And walk in love, that's in Philippians. Imitators, the word imitators is mimetes. Right? It's to mimic. Right? So that's what we're supposed to do. And that's what other people do with us. Especially your kids. Especially your kids. They do that. Let's look at the last one. We'll look along these lines, along this whole idea of zealous. It's Psalm 106. We've read this before when I first... when I had the opportunity to teach the first time, I talked about this passage was in the context of the book of Joshua, because this is really talking about the book of Joshua and what the children of Israel did when they got into the promised land, that is to say, not obeying God's, not obeying what Moses had told them to totally eradicate the inhabitants. They didn't do that. So let's look at 34, I think it is, yeah, 34. We won't read the whole thing, just a couple of verses. This is the they is the children of Israel. They did not destroy the nations concerning whom the Lord commanded them, but were mingled among the heathen and learned their works, and they served their idols, which were a snare unto them. Yea, they sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils. Right. Now, that's a huge leap to, you know, mingle with the nations, to get to the point that you fully engage in their idolatry, to the point that you are willing to sacrifice your son or your daughter. That's a huge leap. That doesn't happen overnight. Just like in our country, it happens a little at a time. Just a little at a time. You eat an elephant a spoonful at a time. Exactly what you do. You run a mile, one step at a time. And that's exactly what happened to the children. They didn't do what Moses said. Back in Deuteronomy 7, if you want to read it, he said, you kill everything. And I mean everything. If it breathes, you kill it. They didn't do that. And you can read about it yourself. But this was the consequence of that. They became what they were willing to peacefully coexist with. Because that's what they did. They peacefully coexist with it. So, this is all along the lines of jealous or zealous. God is zealous for their his relationship with Israel at this point. That's what this is talking about. And you can see how they treated that desire for relationship. They essentially snubbed their nose at it, even though he sent the prophets again and again and again. And we saw the prophets again and again and again. But finally, 2 Chronicles 36, 16, it says there was no remedy. You're done. You're going to captivity. I'll see you in 7 years. He brings them back, and now this is where we're at now. Okay. So, and there's still that sort of complacency, because otherwise you wouldn't see him lay the foundation of the temple, and then because of some resistance, wait 15 or 16 years and just let it sit until Haggai and Zechariah come up and say, what are you doing? You're not treating God the way you treat yourselves. You put nice molding in your houses. You have sealed houses, according to KJV. You have nicely decorated houses. Why aren't you building the temple? You're not even treating God like you treat yourself. So, anyway, that's a little bit more on that idea of zealous or jealous. And let's look. Next thing I want to just bring up to you, and I'm just taking these in the verses, in the order of the verses in the chapter. It's in verse 10, before these days. And really that's talking about, well, we'll go back and read that in a minute. It's really talking about Haggai. It's really talking about the time period after they came back, but when they fell into that period of complacency of 15 to 16 years. It's a bit of a comment. Let's look back at Haggai chapter 1. It's a commentary on the consequence of this complacency for the children of Israel. We'll start in verse 2. Okay, this is Haggai. Thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, this people say the time is not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Again, we're in that 16-year hiatus when they've laid the foundation, but nothing more. Verse 3, then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lying waste? This house referring to the temple. Now therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but you have not enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earns wages to put it into a bag with holes. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, says the Lord. You looked for much, and lo, it came to little. And when you brought it home, I did blow upon it. Why? Says the Lord of hosts, because of mine house that is waste, and ye run every man unto his own house. Therefore the heaven over you is stayed from dew, and the earth is stayed from her fruit. So that's the before these days, you know, when they laid this on, before these days is that period of complacency. Now, remember, Zechariah is prophesying this chapter 4, fourth year of Darius. So they've been now starting again to build the temple for a couple of years. So that's the episode time they're in. Before that, before these days, it's that 16-year hiatus. That's what that passage is talking about. And very simply, just pointing out, there's a consequence for our behavior. There's a consequence for our behavior. Right? If we neglect God, principally, He's going to neglect us. That's the way He set things up. Okay, that is going to happen. That's what we read on here. Let's go back to Zechariah chapter 8. I'm going to touch on this, but I don't want to hit it too hard because some of you might think this is a little controversial, maybe? Possible? Let's read Zechariah chapter 8 in last part of verse 10. We'll read the whole verse. For before these days there was no hire for man, nor any hire for beast, neither was there any peace to him that went out or came in because of the affliction. For I set all men, every one against his neighbor. Now, we know from the New Testament that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. And yet, I'm going to show you some scriptures that would seem to indicate that God does not good things. This one is one of them, where he says, I've set every man against every other. So let's just look at a couple of scriptures. We'll go back to them. Let's look at Exodus chapter 4. We just read these on the screen. We're not going to flip to them. Exodus 4:21. This is God speaking to Moses. It says, but I will harden his heart that he should not let the people go, referring to Pharaoh. Now, if you read through that passage, there are places where it says Pharaoh hardened his heart, and there are places where it says God hardened his heart. Okay, let's go on. Exodus 5:22, Lord, wherefore hast thou so evil entreated this people? That's Moses speaking to God. Why are you doing this to these people, to the children of Israel? Jeremiah 4:10, then said I, Ah, Lord God, surely thou hast greatly deceived this people. And Jerusalem, saying, you shall have peace, whereas the sword reaches unto the soul. And then Ezekiel 20:25, wherefore I gave them, this is God speaking by way of the prophet, wherefore I gave them also statutes that were not good, and judgments whereby they should not live. Now, those are all actions attributed to God in Hebrew Scripture. The only thing I want to point out, and the other one I didn't put on here, I actually sort of forgot to put on here, you may remember, maybe you had memorized the Lord's Prayer. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now, if you read the book of James, it specifically says, If any man is tempted, let him not say that he is tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither can he see any man. And yet the Lord's Prayer says, lead us not into temptation. Now the only thing I want to point out about those which can, I think to some people, and frankly to me initially anyway, seem contradictory, is that there is a... It's a sort of a figure of speech. It's essentially the way that Hebrew as a language worked, their idiom. They would attribute, generally speaking, everything to God, good or bad. And if you think about the revelation in the Old Testament and what we know of the devil, for example, as the evil party, so to speak, it only is, that I'm aware of, as an explicit mention of Satan in Job chapters 1 through about 3, and Chronicles. Other than that, the devil wasn't a known entity. And they were not to mention the name of other gods, of which, of course, the devil would be one. Right? So they're not. Everything is attributed to God. And I just want to point out there's a book called by a fellow named E.W. Bullinger. It's called Figures of Speech in the Bible. He mentions this, I will just call it a Hebrew idiom. And the quote is here, active verbs were used by the Hebrews to express not the doing of the thing, but the permission of the thing. which the agent is sent to do. That is to say, God did not do it, he did permit it. But the way that it is stated, God actually did it. The Pharaoh hardening the heart. Clearly, God didn't harden Pharaoh's heart, Pharaoh did it. God permitted it. And that's what that idiom refers to. When we read in Zechariah 8:10, I set all men everywhere against his name, complacency. That's what Haggai 1 talks about. Their behavior, their complacency brought it about. The Lord allowed it, absolutely. But the Lord didn't do it. Their own activity did. Pharaoh hardened his own heart. Now, again, the reason I'm sharing this is you've got to think about these things and decide what Scripture says. I mean, just because I say it doesn't make it true. You're responsible. 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The word study doesn't mean read. It means diligent effort with attention to the brevity of time. That's what study means. It's the word studazzo. Study is a very convenient King James translation because study at that time meant be diligent. But the point is, you're responsible. I'm responsible, of course, too, but just because I say it doesn't make it true. But this is what I found. And the New Testament passage with Jesus Christ teaching us how to pray, lead us not into temptation, when James specifically says he doesn't tempt any man. I understand that because of this Hebrew idiom. I understand that. Because they attributed these things to God, whether God actually did them or permitted them. Let's take maybe 2 or 3 minutes and just stand up and stretch or walk around or whatever. Truly. Just because, shake a hand. Walk out and get a drink if you need to. That's fine. A couple, 3 minutes. Just a little bit of a break from me talking.
Yes, sir. Is it all right?
Yes, sir.
Was 39 for us.
That is sweet, man.
That's legit, huh?
You get like a medallion or something.
Yeah. Get a little button. You do, Susan?
I will be in April.
Very good.
You're in July.
July 26th, yeah. My oldest son was born on our anniversary. So it was his 31st birthday. Our 39th anniversary.
Being married in 1980 is easy to remember.
Yes, I agree. Absolutely.
How long have you been married?
No. For me?
Yeah.
39 years.
Very good.
That's 3 of us then.
Very good. Outstanding. Nothing like faithful marriage. Okay, let's start again, shall we? The next thing we're going to look at is in Zechariah chapter 8, verse 16. So, we talked about that passage in Haggai, going back to chapter 8, verse 10. We talked about that passage in Haggai about how the natural world reacted to their essentially disobedience or complacency. And then Zechariah, the following verses, talk about, I will not be, verse 11, now I will not be unto the residue of this people as in the former days. Former days referring to that complacency time. So we get down to verse 16. And the King James, and you all's translation may be more accurate. Once again, I don't want to ever say the KJV. Accurate. But verse 16, the King James says, these are the things that you shall do. What does any other translation say there?
Does it
says these are the things? It really does say that?
Yeah, you shall.
Yeah. Really? Okay, so the word things is actually the Hebrew word for words. These are the words that you shall do. And the reason that I think that is significant to me is, we've talked about this before, but please look back at Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6.
in the Shema, we'll look at verse 7 and just look at a couple of things, not a lot, just a little. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 7. Actually, it's verse, starting verse 6. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and thou shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. So, words were central. Right? The words that Moses spoke, those words, or what he said, those are going to be in your heart. He also said, those are the words that you're going to pass down to your children. He also stipulated in that verse, God's revelation teaches us what it is going to take to do that. The phrase teach diligently is the Hebrew word that means to sharpen, which I think I've shared with you before. It's like sharpening a knife. So you have to have one thing that's harder than the knife. And you take the knife and you scrape it across that harder material. And you have to take a little metal off. Right? It's not always, when you're speaking about that kind of a process with people, it's not always pleasant. However, it needs to be done. But it's not pleasant. But it also implies that you and I, as, again, Christian men, Christian husbands, Christian fathers, in that order of priority, have done that process ourselves. We have to have done that ourselves. Or a mentor helped us do that in our lives. We have to have gone through that sharpening process where a little bit of metal had to be taken off. Something had to be pruned. We had to have done that, or we couldn't do it for the kids. But then the process, again, is stipulated in that verse. What is it going to take? It's going to take, you've got to talk about these things all the time. Right? They've got to be a priority for you. Now, I just simply want to point out, not pointing any fingers at me or anybody else, but in our society, just, we're talking about societal now, the priority of words in our society, in conversation, in writing, pretty much, well, let's say, first of all, is very simply, it's not sacred. Number two, it's, much of it is either lyrics to songs, or lyrics to movies, or kind of gotcha catchphrases that are in vogue at the time, versus what we're supposed to be doing. So at the very least, once again, this verse talks about the process of passing God's words from one generation to the next. This is what it's going to take. Right? So if we don't do that, then we get what we deserve. We get a generation that doesn't care because we didn't do that in the first place. And again, this presupposes that we're doing this with ourselves. That we, in fact, are making God's word a priority for ourselves. If we're not doing that, then clearly we can't do it for our kids. No way. You're going to pass something on. It's not going to be what you want to pass on. But you're going to pass something on. You absolutely are. As I said, your kids are going to be you. Sooner or later, that's what's going to happen. 99% of the time. I wouldn't say always, but 99% of the time. Anyway, I want to point that up all the words. And then this also, as I mentioned, chapters 7 and 8 of Zechariah are actually sort of a unit. Let's look at chapter 7. And this is in light of what verse 16 of chapter 8 talks about. So let's go to Zechariah chapter 7. This is in light of what verse 16 of chapter 8 talks about with these are the things, or as we learn, these are the words that you shall do. Speak ye every man the truth to his neighbor. Execute judgment. So it's talking about godly interrelationship. That is to say, behaving the way God stipulated and designed us to behave to other people. Right? That's also in chapter 7, and we'll start in verse 8. Verse 8, and the word of the Lord came unto Zechariah, saying, thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, execute true judgment, and show mercy, and compassions every man to his brother, and oppress not the widow, nor the fatherless, the stranger, nor the poor. And let none of you imagine evil against his brother in your heart. And then verse 11, but they refused to hearken, and pulled away the shoulder, stopped their ears,
that they should not hear, yea, they made their hearts as an adamant stone. That is a great passage and such a commentary on human nature. Interestingly, of course, God's words, when they're spoken, are typically in the context of the culture in which they're spoken. So when, again, I don't know what the more modern translation would say, but when it says, pulled away the shoulder, that's on the analogy of what oxen would do if you were trying to yoke them, and they didn't want to be yoked. They would pull away their shoulder, right? Or when it says they made their heart an adamant stone. First of all, who was the active party in that verse? Right? Who was the active party? Yea, they made their hearts as an adamant stone. Who was the active party? Who did that?
People.
People, right. They made their hearts an adamant stone. One of the only things, only two things that Jesus Christ was marveled at was hardness of heart and believing. Right. So, an adamant stone, again, a more modern translation, that Hebrew word means a diamond. Can be translated diamond. So they essentially made their heart as hard as a rock. That's exactly what it says. They made their heart as hard as a rock. And again, I'm just relating this because chapters 7 and 8 are a unit. But he says this is where you're supposed to behave in 7, 8, and following, but they didn't do it. We see that again in chapter 8 as well. He says, okay, here's all I want you to do. I just want you to treat people, execute judgment, do the right thing, take care of the fatherless, take care of the poor. That's all you got to do. This is not rocket science, guys. But they wouldn't do it. They wouldn't do it. I wanted to mention this word imagine as well. It's in oppress not the widow nor the fatherless, and let none of you imagine evil against his brother in your heart. It's in verse 10 of chapter 7. The word imagine, the Hebrew word imagine here means to weave. The root word means to weave. So it is very simply sort of plotting. Right? Plotting to do evil against another person. That's really what this is talking about. I thought of this, you may remember, thought about this in the context of, look at Deuteronomy chapter 5. It's also in the Ten Commandments. Yeah. Deuteronomy chapter 5. We're going to come back to Zechariah, obviously, but Deuteronomy chapter 5. When we had the opportunity and privilege to talk about marriage, one of the things we talked about was the Sermon on the Mount when Jesus said, you know, you've heard that it was said, don't commit adultery, but I'm telling you that if you think about it, if you look at a woman with lust in your heart, you've already done it. I used to think that that was sort of up a notch from what was in the Old Testament law. That the Old Testament law forbade the act. It didn't say anything about the thought. Right? Because Jesus Christ kicks it up to, it's a thought crime. It's a thought sin. If you think about it, you did it. So I thought about that in the context of the Ten Commandments. If you look at Deuteronomy chapter 5 and verse 21, it says, neither shalt thou desire thy neighbor's wife, neither shalt thou covet thy neighbor's house, field, manservant, maidservant, ox, ass, or anything that is your neighbor's. Now, is desire and is covet an action? It's a thought. It's a thought. The first word, there are two different Hebrew words. You know, the desire is one word, the covet is the other one. Desire is to delight in, and the covet is to wish for. Right? Those are thoughts. Jesus Christ, when he gets to the Sermon on the Mount and talks about adultery, he was saying the same thing the law did. It was no different. But you may remember the passage in Matthew 19 when he talks about that marriage can't be dissolved, can't result in divorce except for fornication. And his own disciples say to him, man, if that's the case, it's better not to be married.
his own disciples had fallen into the error of the age that marriage was and should be a dispensable instrument, that you should be able to get out of it for any reason, because that's how that teaching in Matthew 19 started. They come to him and say, can a man divorce a woman for any reason? Well, his disciples were every bit of that opinion. In other words, their answer to that question would have been yes. Because when Jesus says no, only for fornication, they say, better not to be married. I liked it the way it was before you said anything about what you said. But the point is, it was in the Old Testament law. It's in Deuteronomy 5:21. If you delight in it and you wish for it, that's thought, that's not action. You're just thinking about it. And that was forbidden. I think the only other thing I wanted to mention here in the context of Deuteronomy or of Zechariah 8 were the fasts. So let's read Zechariah 8, 18 and 19. And the word of the Lord of hosts came unto me, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, the fast of the fourth month, the fast of the fifth, the fast of the seventh, and the fast of the tenth shall be to the house of Judah joy and gladness and cheerful feasts. Therefore, love the truth and peace. Now, let's talk about what those fasts were, okay, first of all. Because the fourth month, and you can read these if you want to, we won't actually go to these passages, but Jeremiah 52 talks about when Jerusalem was broken up as a city. The fourth month fast, it happened in the fourth month. That's talked about in Jeremiah 52. So the children of Israel instituted a fast to commemorate that event. Right? The fifth month fast was when the temple and the houses were burned. It's talked about in Jeremiah 52. Again, you can read it if you like. They instituted a fast to commemorate that event. The seventh month was when a fellow by the name of Gedaliah was slain by a fellow named Ishmael. You can read the record. It's in Jeremiah 41, but you can read about it. And that was the children of Israel instituted this fast. And then the 10th month fast was when the king of Babylon actually began the siege of Jerusalem. That was, they instituted a fast to commemorate that event. Right? So these are all very, very sad events. None of these are good things. They institute the fast to commemorate these events. So you can see why this verse, talking about what is going to be the triumph of Israel, the rebuilding of the wall, the rebuilding of the temple, the messianic prophecies when not only at that time is the temple going to be rebuilt, but the messianic temple is going to be the final victory. You can see why this verse says all these fasts commemorating all those sad events are actually going to be joyful, because all of that's going to be a distant memory. That's what the verse is really talking about. But the other thing I wanted to point out to you is there's only one fast stipulated in the Mosaic Law, and that was the fast on the Day of Atonement. There were no other fasts at all stipulated by the Mosaic Law, except the Day of Atonement. So all these other ones they're talking about were instituted by the people, not by God. Right. So just want to point that out. But that's why he says they're going to be happy, because there is going to be the victory that God is going to bring about. Even though these fasts were designed to commemorate nationally sad events. And the only thing we have, I thought about this, we don't have many events in the United States that we would nationally be sorrowful for. If you were alive at the time, John F. Kennedy's assassination was, the nation was in mourning. Probably Martin Luther King was close, at least, but the nation was in mourning violently for that one. There are probably others that just don't come to mind, but we don't have much that compares to Israel's loss of Jerusalem or being carried away to a foreign country. We can't identify with that. We don't have anything like that. But that's what they instituted these feasts for, these fasts for. The other thing I wanted to talk about, though, just briefly, was fasting in general. Because it comes up, look at Isaiah 58. Fasting was a part of the children of Israel's religious observance, not all because it was in the Mosaic Law. As I mentioned, there was only one fast stipulated in the Mosaic Law.
But fasting was something that they did by way of religious observance. And Isaiah 58 talks about that. We're going to actually, it's not a long chapter, we're actually going to read through it. And I'll read, and hopefully you can overlook the these and the thous. Cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgression, and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily, and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness, and forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching to God. Wherefore have we fasted, say they, and thou seest not? Wherefore have we afflicted our soul, and thou takest no knowledge? Behold, in the day of your fast, you find pleasure, and exact all your labors. Behold, you fast for strife and debate, and to smite with the fist of wickedness. Ye shall not fast as ye do this day, to make your voice to be heard on high. Is it such a fast that I have chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head as a bulrush, and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? Wilt thou call this a fast, and an acceptable day to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke? Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that they are cast out to thy house? When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and that thou hide not thyself from thine own flesh. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and thy health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee, and the glory of the Lord shall be thy rear reward. Then shalt thou call, and the Lord shall answer, and thou shalt cry, and he shall say, Here I am. Now, do you recognize that in this passage, the way that they were supposed to conduct themselves toward others is exactly what we read about in Zechariah 7 and 8, the very same thing. Last scripture we'll go to, look at Matthew 6, Matthew chapter 6. Remember, between Zechariah, the record we're reading, and Jesus Christ's presence on earth is 400 years. Right. Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, verse 16. This is Jesus Christ's first public address. Right? This is the Sermon on the Mount, his first public address. Matthew 6:16. Moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrites, of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou fastest, anoint thine head and wash thy face, that thou appear not unto men to fast, but unto thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which sees in secret shall reward thee openly. So the false fasting, if you will, was still going on 400 years later. The same thing that Isaiah condemns, the same thing that's talked about in Zechariah, in Jesus Christ's time with the Pharisees and Sadducees, the same thing. Right. So, again, this stuff is generational. The good's generational, but so is the bad. That's all I had to share regarding Zechariah chapter 8. I'll close with prayer, and then if anybody has any questions or comments. Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for your word, for the light that it is to our path. We thank you for its pertinence to today, that the lessons that your word teaches us that were written down, in this case, 2,500 years ago, are just as alive now as they were then. And again, pray for your word to sink into our hearts, that truth, and that something that we can take away and actually apply to be better Christian men, Christian husbands, Christian fathers. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.